If I begin in introducing myself rather shortly, I am originally from Finland, and I received my PhD from University of Helsinki. I wrote it on the Polish question in 19th century in the Russian Empire, and I came across Ukrainians, young Poles by their origin, who wanted to switch to Ukrainian identity, and that's how I became interested in the Ukrainian national movement, Ukrainian question, Ukraine in general, and I think I have found my focus of research in this. Brothers or enemies? It is, of course, a provocative title. I would want to them to be brothers, but the reality is not always what we want. And I refer to discussions within the Ukrainian circles. In that small circle of intelligentsia, which pondered over their nation, their country, and what is its relation to Russia. So my book almost is a general history of the Ukrainian movement at that time, in three decades, from the 1840s to 1870. But it has a special focus, and it is focused on the Russian question within the Ukrainian movement, and very different solutions to this Russian question were proposed. However, as a rule, I would say that Ukrainians wanted to distance themselves from both Russian Empire and Russians as a nation. This is not as simple as that, but if I put it in a nutshell, I would say that this was the mainstream opinion. In addition to the ideas in Ukrainian circles, I research also the imperial policies. And here I would say, in a somewhat similar way, the mainstream opinion within the imperial bureaucracy was that the Ukrainian movement needs to be repressed. There are some remarkable exceptions. Individuals and events where occasionally the government and Ukrainian activists even cooperated, but this tends to be a minority current. It was a very modest movement. Only a few books in Ukrainian appeared at that time. The government was as yet not alert to any danger in the Ukrainian movement. This happened, it got alerted to possible dangers connected with Ukrainian identity in 1847, when the Society of Saint Cyril and Saint Methodius was called. By the way, this was the name of this organization. I don't know whence Brotherhood has appeared, but definitely several decades after the events. This was called Cyril Methodian Society by the contemporaries. And however, the repression which followed uncovering of the Cyrilo Methodian Society, which was both a Pan-Slav and Ukrainian nationalist organization, in a sense that Ukrainians were to have their own state within a Pan-Slav federation. The repressions were somewhat measured. Nevertheless, there was no general ban on Ukrainian publications. Censorship was somewhat more alert to Ukrainian nationalism than before 1847, but the language as such was not repressed. Indeed, what is somewhat surprising is that the first religious books in Ukrainian in the Russian Empire appear in these years, in the end of the Nicholas I's reign, late 1840s, early 1850s. Then, of course, in when Alexander II became Tsar Emperor of Russia in 1855, as in many other fields, this also gave the Ukrainian intelligentsia much greater opportunities to work and to disseminate their message to public. Ukrainian publishing became really important, I would say, in the end of 1850s and the beginning of 1860s. This is also a time of very lively political discussions. Most Ukrainians understood that there is no way to gain, I would say, either independence or a federal system anytime soon. But these questions were nevertheless discussed, and I was somewhat surprised to find out how often either separation from Russia or Ukrainian independence. Most remarkably, perhaps, Volodymyr Antonovich, in a text written most likely in 1861, writes about Ukraine's right to have Ukraine's right to independence in future. So it's not an immediate goal, but it's located sometime at some point in future. Then there came the Valuyev repressive Valuyev directive, which banned formally banned all nonfiction and all literature in general which was directed to peasants. However, there were great fluctuations in how this rule was indeed implemented. In the rest of the 1860s, after 1863, it was very difficult to publish anything in Ukrainian, even the books which were formally permitted in the Valuyev Directive or Valuyev Circular. Whereas in the 1870s, it was easier again, mainly because of the local circumstances in Kyiv. By the way, there is Ukrainian publishing switches from St. Petersburg to Kyiv definitely only in the beginning of 1870s. Its center, I mean, of course. There were many places where books in Ukrainian were published. There was a local censor who was corrupted, and he took collective bribes from Kyiv Hromada. And this facilitated publishing of about 30 titles per year. And this was possible because also Governor General was not very hostile to the Ukrainian movement at that time, Dondukov Karsakov. But this was not connected with any change in the general policies of the government, which were in St. Petersburg. People were still supporting repressions against Ukrainian publishing. And so this resulted in the entry decree, which reinforced in somewhat more severe form the restrictions on Ukrainian publishing, which were decreed first time in 1863. Galicia, the influence definitely went from the Russian Empire to Galicia, not the other way around. It was Ukrainians from Dnipro, Ukraine, who supported Galicians financially, and some people in the government, in the Russian government, were concerned over that, and they wanted to support the local Russophiles as a reaction to the Ukrainian activists. So Ukrainian activists were there first. That is my impression. To be sure, I am not a Galician specialist. That's a separate research. Now, concerning Poles in general, relation to Poland is very interesting. I would say that the Ukrainian movement emerged in opposition to both Poland and Russia. But there was a very dramatic moment when the Poles made their January insurrection of 1863-64, and it actually extended to right bank Ukraine, even rather close to Kyiv. Battles were fought, and so this was a local event, and Ukrainians had to react to this. As a rule, Ukrainians sided with the Russian government. because this gave them locally good opportunities to work in Sunday schools to publish their books. And so on. This was based on informal agreement between Ukrainians and Governor General of Kyiv, Ilarion Vasilchikov. However, situation changed completely when Vasilchikov unexpectedly died in 1862. And his successor gave in to pressure from St. Petersburg and agreed in repression against Ukrainians. What was the short-term motivation for this repression in general? There was a certain officer called Andrei Krasovsky in 1862, and in his possession rather many texts were found which included those where independence was discussed. I think this was the immediate trigger to repressions against Ukrainian movement. However, it was well known that most Ukrainians were against the Polish insurrection. And so some disinformation was also needed in order to create an image that Ukrainians are in the same camp with Poles. And this was created by forging two political cases against Ukrainians, which had no substance. Perhaps more remarkable of these seen from present day is a deportation of Pavlo Chubinsky, who was the author of Ukrainian National Anthem, Che Nemerla Ukraina. He was charged of writing a proclamation to peasants where he called the peasants to rise, supposedly in cooperation with the Polish insurgents. I give grounds why I think that that it was the Russian gendarmes who wrote this proclamation, actually. And he was deported to Arkhangelsk province because of this fake proclamation. Such measures were, in the imperial administration, they were not quite usual, but not absolutely extraordinary. They were decent people compared to the Soviet Stalinist repressive machinery. But I think why did they do such a thing was that rather many imperial bureaucrats, imperial politicians knew that Ukrainians are a different group. They do not cooperate with Poles. And it was necessary to create an image of Ukrainian-Polish conspiracy. And that's why these kind of things were done. Likewise, in the famous Valuyev Directive, it is said that most of the manuscripts in Ukrainian submitted to censorship in Kyiv are written by Poles. I present just statistical information, which this is disinformation. There was one Pole who submitted a manuscript in Ukrainian in 1862, and there were tens of them. So this image of Ukrainian siding with Poles and Polish conspiracy being behind of this all, it was an intentional and conscious government creation. I would say also, a person who wants to be decently educated in this question needs to read three books, and one of them is mine. But there are two good books before me. One was written by Fedor Savchenko and published in 1930. He in Kyiv, in Soviet Ukraine, he had to write somewhat in haste because he was repressed in 1931. At that time, Ukrainization policies were already being heavily criticized, and it might have been impossible to publish that book only somewhat later. So that's why he did not have time to consult as many archives as I have. Another thing is that it was written, of course, in 1920s, and studies of nationalism have developed tremendously after that. I am informed by general development in this field, and I perhaps problematize Ukrainian identity more than he does. I mean, for instance, I studied the question whether Ukrainian identity was considered inclusive as compatible with Russian identity, or whether it was considered exclusive, as a person cannot be Ukrainian and Russian at the same time. Savchenko does not present these questions. By the way, it was more often exclusive. Then there is a book by Alexei Miller, The Ukrainian Question, originally published in 2000 in Russian and in 2003 in English. Miller is a Russian scholar who has, I think I am fair to him if I say that he has a Russian imperial viewpoint. He's informed by all the recent scholarship concerning empires and nationalism, etc., but he's more interested in the government politicians than Ukrainians themselves. Although he found out something interesting, for instance, the first mention of Ukrainian independence as a long-term goal by Panteleimon Kulish in 1858. And then he sometimes ignores information which shows the empire in a more repressive light than if that information is taken into account. I have a broader source base, and I would say that I'm an outsider. I guess after this book, perhaps someone will blame me that I'm a Ukrainian nationalist. I am not. I'm an outsider. But I take Ukrainian nationalism as a serious phenomenon, which is not fundamentally different from any other Eastern European nationalism in the 19th century. I agree with Jaroslav Hrycak, who has written that Ukrainian nationalism is, after all, rather normal compared to the other Eastern European nationalism. It's not an anomaly or very exceptional as such. There is a greater political tension because of the all-Russian idea, which the Russian Empire in principle supported, according to which Ukrainians, Belarusians, Great Russians form one all-Russian nation. And of course, once this all-Russian idea, to which Miller pays very much attention, was so widespread in the government circles, Ukrainian movement was bound to be, to some extent, oppositional, even regardless of the intentions of the Ukrainian activists. However, I would say that as a rule, they were, even in social questions, they were people who were markedly to the left from the imperial government. Very, and this is nothing new, very, they supported interests of peasantry, etc. Pyotr Valuyev, who was the real father of these repressions against Ukrainian publishing, just regardless of its contents, on the basis of mere language, he thought that expansion of Ukrainian identity and Ukrainian ideas in the lower classes of society can be prevented by this way. I think this was an unrealistic goal. After all, Imperial Russia didn't have such effective machinery of repression that they could have defeated the Ukrainian movement just by administrative measures. Indeed, when we look at the sheer numbers of Ukrainian publishing, even under these restrictions, it's increasing towards 1905, with some fluctuation, but nevertheless. And so it is growing all the time, regardless of government policies. And if the government were more sensible, they might have thought about some other means to act against the Ukrainian movement instead of repression. But they chose repression. There were some voices in the government against repression. Most remarkable, perhaps, is Minister of Education in the beginning of 1860s, Alexander Galomnin, who criticized Valuyev directive in very strong words, and stated as his general opinion that any book can be permitted or banned on the basis of its contents, but no, not on the basis of its language. And he was indeed right in that in European history, modern history of 19th and 20th centuries, this is almost unique, restrictions against a language. I have found an analogy only in Spain under General Franco, where minority languages like Catalonian language were restricted in the same, pretty much the same way. To put it very shortly, my main thesis is that when government was concerned over that there are revolutionaries in the movement, in the Ukrainian movement, that was not a paranoia, it was true. A rather few Ukrainians actually participated in revolutionary activities like disseminating leaflets or joining underground revolutionary All-Russian organization Land and Liberty, although there are such cases. And the officer Krasovsky, whom I mentioned, was agitating soldiers not to suppress peasant disturbances nearby. And that was how he was caught. However, if we look at discussions within Ukrainian circles, even they overstepped the limits of what was law at that time. And they definitely show that that Ukrainians very often had revolutionary sympathies, although they did not practice any revolutionary actions. There is a strict difference if a person discusses with his friends political ideals, that's one thing. And then, of course, if he joins actually an underground organization, that's another thing. And I would say that only a few Ukrainians joined actually some underground organizations, but the sympathy to revolutionary ideas was much more widespread, and this was known to the government. And there are incidents of people participating both in the Ukrainian movement and in the All-Russian revolutionary movement at the same time. And I mean, of course, for government politicians, it is alarming news that there are discussions about independence, although there are no actual plans to try to gain independence right now. But I understand their concern, only their response was inept. Kulish is somewhat unique in his many twists and turns. However, I find there's some constancy also. Sometimes it is written that he abandoned the movement in older age. I don't find that to be true at all. He still supported all the cultural rights for Ukrainian language and found it important to write in Ukrainian, etc. And these were unavoidably political matters in the Russian Empire. Kulish was very much in the mainstream of the movement until the first years of the 1860s. Thereafter he goes his own way. Concerning Russia, there is a very interesting incident in the beginning of 1850s when he considered literary cooperation with the third section, with the imperial authorities, who also considered that he might be useful as an anti-Polish person. But in the end, when he wrote, and because of his former sentence, he had to submit everything at first to the third section, and only from there it passed to the ordinary censorship, third section, political police, if they found it appropriate. They got disappointed in what he wrote, and they advised him not to write at all. And when he then in the 1870s, he again approaches Russian government kind of, at least literally, in his texts. This is not completely new. He was thinking about the cooperation with the government even earlier. And of course, he was in the 1860s, he was for several years serving in the Kingdom of Poland in government position. But in other sense, he is not fully unique. We have people who have the same idea what Kulish held in his older age, that Ukraine and Russia are two separate nations, but nevertheless, they are close to each other and they have a special relationship with each other, and they should remain politically together. This idea, I would say, was supported also by Mikhail Rahmanov. Although Rahmanov was much more radical in social questions than Kulish. And a third person, I would say, who comes close to that idea is Mikhailo Maksimovich. It has been even claimed that Maksimovich did not envision a separate Ukrainian nationality at all, and that he did not perceive a connection between language and nationality. I reject that most forcefully. He explicitly supported the idea that language defines nationality, and that is why he also found that Ukrainians and Russians are two separate nations. Nevertheless, he thought that they were closely related, had a special relationship, and should remain politically together. In the 1840s, this movement was still mainly in that it had a great potential. But what was actually done was not so much. Perhaps one, perhaps two books per year appeared. There were discussions in small intellectual circles. Thereafter, Ukrainian publishing constantly expands until the beginning of 1860s. 1863 is then the Valuya circular. So there is, I would say that from 1847 to 1863, there is constant expansion. Thereafter, there is a step back, but not, I would say, not a full demise of the movement or anything of the sort. People found ways to function within even the very strict limits which the government had set. And thereafter, in the beginning of 1870s, there is a new upsurge, but it does not quite reach the level which was reached in the beginning of 1860s. However, if we look at publishing, although this goes already outside the chronological limits of my book, for instance, in the second half of 1880s, more Ukrainian books were published in the Russian Empire than ever before, which just we normally do not think about because restrictions were in force and government policy was repressive, etc. But this is nevertheless, despite. Well, first, that there was this very lively movement, which was which is a substantial part, I would say, not only of Ukrainian but also Russian imperial history, and that it was not in some Austrian general staff or Bolshevik committee where this movement was discovered. It emerged gradually during quite long period in the 19th century. Then concerning the questions I study at first, I would say that there is a clear tendency to distance from Russia, even when it's not formally anything illegal or political written, right up to things like Russian personages in Ukrainian books are very often embodiments of negative stereotypes. People prone to domination, violent, do not respect women, do not appreciate learning or any high ideals. High ideals, they just want to gather material, wealth, etc. All these stereotypes are there, and their purpose was to distance Ukrainians from Russians. Although we have also, I have spoken about already about that, so it's not necessary anymore to repeat, we have also these ideas of special relationship. Then, politically, this movement was varied. Some were outright revolutionaries, but not very many. The mainstream thought that by gaining cultural rights to Ukrainians and by disseminating Ukrainian identity among the common people, at some point in the future, it might be possible to reach even politically a better arrangement to Ukraine. What would that political arrangement be? Well, it was discussed. Some spoke about independence, others spoke about Pan-Slav Federation, where Ukraine would have a status of a federal state. And occasionally there was discussion about a federation without Russia, but including Ukraine. Federation, for instance, with other Slavic nations. This is much more, the nationalism I have studied is much more nationalism with a human face. To be sure, here and there, I may perceive germs of later undemocratic, intolerant nationalism, but then these are not dominant at this time. Ukrainians had somewhat problematic relation with Jews already in the 19th century. But it was not the case that there was any attempt to completely exclude them. And as a whole, Ukrainian activists of the 19th century, very fundamental to their ideas was basic human equality. All humans are equal. That's also why Ukrainian peasants, who were really oppressed at that time, in every sense, politically, socially, economically, that's why they should be elevated on the same level with the rest of the society. And that's what I find attractive in general. Then I would say that what made an impression to me otherwise is that how flexible this movement was. Against all odds, they found a way to put their message through and found a way to work even in conditions which were not favorable, and they did not give up. Of course, also the repressions which they faced were not of the Stalinist level. They were much milder and more modest. I would say that the whole ideological thrust in general is to greater equality in society. Without, I would say, any very strong ideas of class struggle or considering necessarily the upper classes of society as enemies. We have also such examples, Serhii Podolinsky, first of all, among Ukrainians of the 19th century, who was very, very radical leftist. But for instance, reading, I don't think words like liberty and equality are there to be seen very often, because those were noise words for the censors. But reading, for instance, Kievsky Telegraph of 1875, which Kiev Romada controlled, I was and indeed surprised by how practical this newspaper was. It discussed economic questions. It wrote a lengthy article about a new legislation concerning the rights of the employees, and criticized the law for that employers have all the rights and employees have practically none or very few. And this was all put in a very business-like tone, discussing clause by clause the law. And so these people were interested in even small things in society, small improvements, gradual improvements. They were not utopians. Well, I would like to say that although it's unavoidable that we discuss history and past history, even 19th century history, in the light of today, we should be able to discuss 19th century events with open mind. And for instance, this provocative title, Brothers or Enemies, and all the Ukrainian ideas about distancing themselves from Russia, and how Russians are stereotypic ideas about Russians are, I think, what is now not needed in Ukraine. I mean, we should separate the present-day political discussion and perhaps even negative long-term trends in Russian policies, which definitely exist. We can discern a certain pattern from 1863 to present day in reluctance to admit that Ukrainians exist as a separate nation. However, it is not inherently unavoidable that this will be so to the end of the world, and even Russians can change in this sense. And so the answer to this question also, it may change from generation to generation and century to century. Yes. Well, there are stereotypes on both sides, but my book is somewhat asymmetric in a sense that I don't study the perception of Russian general public about Ukrainians. I do study perception of Ukrainian activists of Russians. And I already named several aspects of this these rather prominent stereotypes which existed in literature, I would say, through all this period, more or less. And it is Russians are prone to dominate. They are either irreligious, or if religion is not relevant for the Ukrainian author, then they are they don't care about any high ideals at all. They are materialistic. They think about their immediate interest. They are portrayed as looking down on Ukrainians, and this probably is a realistic description of this part of the of those Ukrainian stereotypes. However, I wonder whether at any time any Russian person existed anywhere, even in Uryupinsk, who would fit into that, into all those negative stereotypes. And why do they repeat themselves so often? I think it's a psychological compensation which Ukrainian activists get because they are working under very difficult conditions which are set by the Russian government. And also it is because among the intelligentsia there were very many people with blurred identity. Somewhat Ukrainian, somewhat Russian, as we have today such people. And construction of stereotypes of Russians is a way to promote exclusive Ukrainian national identity, which is not necessarily connected with such stereotypes, but it is one method to promote it. And it's interesting how even some people like Oleksa Storozhenko, who later made quite successful career with the government, and even in service of Russificatory policies against Poles, even he writes in some of his texts, which were published in Asnova in the beginning of 1860s, in this way about Russians. On the Russian side, I would say that the most important stereotype is the idea of the Ukrainian movement as artificial, which is still problematic and still has wide support in Russia. Of course, Ukrainian movement is artificial in a sense that all national movements are artificial and they are made by people. But it is not constructed by some third force, as many people imagine today, and some people imagined at that time. I think Russians were prone to think about separate Ukrainian identity as a Polish trick, just by reaction and instinct. I do not write about it in this book, but for instance, one of the comments by Nicholas I about the Cyrilo-Methodians points to that direction. However, once this image gets sanctioned as an official view on the Ukrainian movement, this is based on intentional and conscious lying, disinformation. First of all, by Pyotr Valuyev, and this reinforces these stereotypes, of course. I think by the end of the 19th century, many more Russian bureaucrats genuinely believed these ideas than was the case in 1860s. They did not go back to the sources like I do.